Julian joins us now on our Newsmaker line. Julian, welcome back to the program. Thank you for being with us.
G'day, Sean.
I know you follow the news closely. I know you see the narrative. Now, there is a big brouhaha in the United States. The same media, by the way, that WikiLeaks exposed as colluding with Hillary Clinton's campaign, with near hysteria getting up to the president and John Podesta with Hillary's campaign, claiming over and over and over again that it's clear the CIA says so, even though there's no new evidence whatsoever that we didn't have prior to the election, and that the FBI contradicts, and James Clapper, the National Director of Intelligence, contradicts, that in fact the Russians tried to influence in the elections, and this hacked information came from them, and you're saying that is outright false. That's a falsehood.
Our source is not the Russian government.
So in other words, let me be clear. Russia did not give you the Podesta documents or anything from the DNC.
That's correct.
Can you confirm whether or not you have information involving hacked info from the RNC?
We received about 3 pages of information to do with the RNC and Trump, but it was already public somewhere else.
Okay, so in other words, it was nothing significant. There was nothing comparable to what happened. So what Reince Priebus said on NBC to Chuck Todd this weekend was true, and NBC had it wrong.
Well, as far as we're aware of.
As far as you're aware of.
Yeah.
Now, the CIA supposedly says the Russians definitely tried to influence the U.S. election. What is your thoughts on that?
I think it's very interesting. The key quote for us is from James Clapper on the 17th of November. James Clapper is the head of the DNI. He's the Director of National Intelligence, who oversees all 17 U.S. intelligence agencies. And so his statement is, as far as the WikiLeaks connection, this is made to the House Intelligence Committee, as far as the WikiLeaks connection, the evidence is not strong, and we don't have a good insight into the sequencing of the releases or when the data may have been provided. We don't have good insight into that. So
let me, for the sake of our audience, Julian, yeah, let me play the exact quote. This is James Clapper, the Director of National Intelligence, saying exactly what you did, that in fact the Russian government, well, to what he exactly said, that in fact he was very, very clear in saying that WikiLeaks' connection with Russian hacking is not strong.
Watch. As far as the WikiLeaks connection, the evidence there is not as strong, and we don't have good insight into the sequencing of the releases or when the data may have been provided. We don't have as good insight into that.
So that confirms exactly what you're saying. Can you answer whether or not there's a report out today, and there was a report out earlier this week, that in fact they can trace back some leaks to the Department of Homeland Security as it relates to the state of Georgia? Do you know anything about those?
Let's pull back a bit. There's a deliberate attempt this week to conflate a whole lot of different issues together. It seems to be as a desire, an extremely dangerous and foolish desire to flip members of the U.S. Electoral College around into getting up John Kasich or Hillary Clinton on the 19th.
Mm-hmm.
It's foolish because it won't happen. It's dangerous because the argument that it should happen can be used in 4 years' time or 8 years' time for a sitting government that doesn't want to hand over power. And that's a very dangerous thing. There's Clinton-aligned PACs putting out ads with lots of celebrities trying to push these electors to do it. So how are they rhetorically going about it? Well, there's our publications that did make a significant influence during election. Lots and lots of Americans took them up, read them, analyzed them, forwarded them to each other. It was the most discussed topic, according to Facebook, throughout October. Okay, but then we have U.S. intelligence saying they don't know how we got our stuff or when we got it, and us saying we didn't get it from a state. Then there's hacking of various systems that have occurred, okay, presumably to get intelligence. The Israelis do it, the Russians do it, the Chinese do it, The French do it every year and every election cycle to understand what policies are. So it's no surprise at all that there's record of Russians or others hacking a lot of these systems. That's
Let me put this a different way. The state of Georgia in the United States, the Secretary of State there now confirms 10 separate cyber attacks on its network that were all traced back to the U.S. Department of Homeland Security addresses. Do you know anything about that?
I don't know about this specific case, but the state hacking I do know about because I followed it when it first came up in the original FBI report. look, these are about election voter registration systems, not vote counting systems.
Right.
It seems to be just basic identity theft. If you read what DHS said at the time, it said that it looked like these were going to be sold online in black markets. Is the FSB going to be selling voter registration records online in black markets? No, of course. It's almost overwhelmingly likely that it is just identity theft.
Let me ask you this.
As far as the DHS attacks are concerned, that could be a number of things. It could be the DHS just testing security, and then people using the logs of those tests, or rather misusing them, to try and claim that, that there's been attempted hacks of these systems.
Well, I certainly respect, and by the way, it is important to point out some of your history. When you were 16 years old, you did hack into NASA. You did hack into the Department of Defense, and I believe one other agency. Is that true?
There's a number of books saying that.
Okay. So there's a pretty good chance it might be true.
Never been charged for that. No. I would like to keep it that way.
Yeah, that's true. Maybe the statute of limitations has moved on.
I think it has, actually.
I have said that there are two things that America needs to take from you and some of these other high-profile cases, and one is there's proof positive that we don't really have cybersecurity at a level we need for a country that is so actively involved in intelligence and influencing world events, etc. So you've done us a favor, because now we could fix the problem if we so desired, but in all the years President Obama's been in office, he did nothing to fix it. The second thing that I think you did for America, which I think is very important, is you exposed how corrupt our government is, and I'll get to that in a second. Without revealing your sources, would it be fair to say that the information as it relates to WikiLeaks and John Podesta's emails came from within the United States to you?
We have said it has not come from a state party. We know where it came from originally, of course. It's John Podesta. It's from the DNC, etc. There's been no claim that has been held up. No, it's not even maintained anymore that any of the information has been modified or is fake.
So you can't confirm or deny if this information came from within the United States?
We're unhappy that we felt that we needed to even say that it wasn't a state party. Normally we say nothing at all, but we have a conflict of interest. We have an excellent reputation, a strong interest in protecting our sources, and so never saying anything about them, never ruling anyone in or anyone out. We sometimes do it. We don't like to do it. We have another interest, which is maximizing the impact of our publications.
Let me ask you this, then.
So here, in order to prevent a distraction attack against our publications, we've had to come out and say, no, it's not a state party. Stop trying to distract in that way. Pay attention to the content of the publication.
So in other words, when you say state party, it wasn't another state like Russia or some other country.
Correct.
Let me ask you about WikiLeaks, and I think this could shake up the political world. Is it true, an email sent in July of this year that you have that describes how funds could be diverted from the Clinton campaign to the super PACs of Jeb Bush, Carly Fiorina, and John Kasich, specifically document number 107-8645, and it reads, JBCFJK PACs will be noticeably silent for the rest of the campaign. Each will receive a significant allowance from advertising budget, HRC, Hillary is in the loop, and talk to all three personally, eyes only. Is that a legitimate?
I don't have that in front of me. We have published nearly 100,000 documents. So, I mean, I have seen references to things like that. I don't recall seeing an eyes only phrase.
Do you recall any quid pro quo as it relates to Senator Lindsey Graham that he would get some assistance merely, in other words, when he ran for re-election for the Senate, I believe, in 2020?
I don't know. Lindsey Graham is in the Podesta emails.
Yes. All right. Well, that's something that maybe, hopefully, over time we'd be able to follow up on. I have so many more questions for you. Let me ask you a couple of these. Do you think the president knows, as you do, that the source was not Russia for WikiLeaks? And I think it's important to point out that for over 10 years, WikiLeaks has never been proven wrong, not one single time. Do you believe the president is purposefully advancing this for political purposes to delegitimize Donald Trump?
Yes.
Do you?
It's clear if you look at the statements by James Clapper. He also made an earlier statement that the U.S. intelligence is not aware of when we received material or how. So it's pretty clear that he must be getting those briefings as well if the public is getting them. So there's a deliberate attempt to conflate. Basically, as far as the public is concerned, the only interesting thing that happened is that WikiLeaks published a number of different types of information, the DNC publications, John Podesta's, and a variety of Clinton emails obtained under Freedom of Information Act. So that's what's interesting to the public.
By the way, it would not be the first time the CIA was politicized. You might remember during the Benghazi case, I actually spent time on this program talking to the people that were there on the ground while the attack was going on. The American people were told a very different story, that this was, quote, a spontaneous demonstration related to a YouTube video. And I just don't know many demonstrations that are spontaneous where they happen to have in their back pocket RPGs and mortar rounds, which were fired at the consulate and the compound.
That's false, and our publications show that Hillary Clinton knew it's false. There's a letter from Hillary Clinton to Chelsea Clinton.
Yes.
Chelsea Clinton uses an assumed name, Diane Reynolds, and that's the day after the attack where she says, in fact, mm-hmm. it was a group.
Well, my point was, though, the CIA advanced that false story, that it was a spontaneous demonstration, when we now know it was a terrorist attack, and they advanced it through the CIA and Langley. There were some people there that were playing politics at the CIA, advancing a false narrative, a story that we know is false. All right, Julian, if you can, just stay right there. We'll come back. We'll continue more with Julian Assange and his insight as the founder and director of WikiLeaks and more as the Sean Hannity Show continues. As we continue our interview with WikiLeaks founder and director, Julian Assange. Let me ask you this. You never thought Donald Trump would win. Why?
I didn't think he would win. I thought he had a much higher chance than what the polling was giving. I had gone through Brexit. And there's a very similar case in Brexit where you had a new nationalist feeling in the country and disenfranchisement with existing elites. But there was polling, a number of professional pollsters coming up to Brexit, and they got it wrong because people misled the pollsters in two different ways. And to be frank, some of the pollsters also wanted to be misled. But so those people who were going to vote against Brexit said that they were going to vote for it, and those people who were going to vote for it said they're going to vote against it. And the same thing happened, it seems, in the case of Donald Trump's election. So why is that? There was intense pressure in the United States from the mainstream media to make people feel ashamed of wanting to vote for Donald Trump, and to make them feel like that they had to vote for Hillary Clinton even though they didn't want to. And actually, I think it's this second case of Hillary Clinton supporters falsely telling pollsters that they would vote for her and then not doing it that made the difference in the election. So I had assumed that these pollsters had seen the Brexit situation and had taken that into account. They said that they had taken it into account, and that was not true. Now, very interestingly, I think that if the polling had been accurate, Donald Trump wouldn't have won.
Interesting.
Now, why do I say that? Well, Hillary Clinton's campaign outspent Donald Trump by almost 2-1. If the polling had been accurate, bankers and other cashed-up interests would have given Hillary Clinton, you know, another $5 billion. And she would have blasted that in advertising everywhere. But they didn't give her all that money because they didn't perceive that there was a need to, because she seemed that she was 4 or 5 points ahead in the polls. So they got fooled by the polling and therefore didn't spend the amount of money that they needed to on their campaign, and didn't recruit other resources, so, you know, recruit even more mainstream media resources to beat up Trump and to defend Clinton, because they didn't think there was a need to.
Let me ask you, you remember when the New York Times was going full throttle with the story about Donald Trump's taxes, which was stolen information at the time, and everybody in the media thought it was fair and it was legitimate coverage, and they, how they got a hold of it was not an issue in any way. You view yourself and you view WikiLeaks the same way. You view yourself as a journalist. Information came to you, and you disseminated that information because you felt the public had a right to know. What is the difference between what you and WikiLeaks have done versus what the New York Times and CNN does when they publish Donald Trump's taxes that were received illegally or received?
There is a difference. Our stuff has more impact.
Well, that's a good... Okay, touche. I can't disagree with that. Very good point. But in other words, you do view WikiLeaks. One of the things in the conversations that I've had with you both on radio and TV is how important it is for you to maintain a perfect record and not get anything wrong in terms of the information that you acquire, that you release. You want it to be right, and so far you've been right every time.
So far we've been right since we were founded a decade ago. Yeah, it's a very valuable thing to have that perfect record. It's also a curse because we have to work so hard to keep it.
Understood. And my big fear 10 years ago, which you and I discussed the last time you were on my radio show, when I wanted you arrested, I said, because I felt you would release potential information that would result in methods and people potentially dying, because there is so much in terms of covert operations, people working undercover. You purposely choose not to publish that information, correct?
Well, yes. If you're talking about Afghanistan, there were 15,000 documents that we didn't release in the,
because you thought people's lives would be in jeopardy immediately.
No, but we thought that there was a reasonable possibility, so that we wanted to study the issue further. So we didn't think that people's lives would definitely be in jeopardy, but we weren't sure, so we wanted to hold things back till we understood it.
Yeah. All right. I have a lot more questions for you. Let me ask you a few of these, because I think this is very important for our audience to fully, completely grasp and to understand. So you only had three pages on the RNC. Do you think the media in the U.S. is trying to scapegoat you, and what message do you have for them?
They're increasingly not very important.
So true.
I think Trump has even made this statement. I mean, they're a paper tiger in this election, and the new publications on the internet, one can get pretty directly to the people. So these old press are less important. And the degree of bias they've been showing during the electoral process, and it has come from both sides, but I suppose particularly the liberal press, readers see that. They feel it. They don't like being lectured to or told what to do, and they rebel against it. I think this is the other reason why Trump won that no one's speaking about, which is that kind of hectoring from the liberal media in the United States, and the type of advertising that Hillary Clinton was putting out, really turned people off, because it seemed like those people who already had a lot of social power were telling you what to do, and so you wanted to do the opposite.
How easy, from your assessment, as somebody that has been involved in this most of his adult life now, how secure, if you were to give a grade of 1 to 10, 10 being the most secure, how secure is America's agencies, American government, America's secrets?
Everything is almost completely insecure now. The computer systems have become so complex that it is not possible to understand all the parts, let alone secure them. It is just impossible.
So, and that goes for individuals as well as a government?
It goes for all of us, yeah.
Yeah. Do you think there could be a separate operation within the Russian government, separate and apart from the information you have at WikiLeaks?
Okay, so this is interesting. There's a conflation between the three things. WikiLeaks publications, and I've told you what James Clapper says about them, that they can't see how the Russians transfer them to us, etc., that had the impact everyone's talking about. Alleged hacks of the U.S. voting system. You just mentioned the DHS, for example. And other publications appearing on the internet that basically almost no one has heard of that didn't have any impact in the election. In fact, might have had the opposite impact. So in this last category, there's a site called DC Leaks and another and a WordPress site run by a guy calling himself Guccifer 2. Now, who are behind these, we don't know.
Do you know these people?
And there was a couple of publications also by The Hill and by Gawker and The Smoking Gun that claimed that their documents came from, I think, from Guccifer, maybe this DC Leaks. So those look very much like that they're the Russians. But in some ways, they seem very amateur, and they look too much like it. And so this is what, far from me to quote John Bolton, who I think I should be executed or something, but he has said correctly that if something looks so much like that it is meant to be the Russians, then maybe someone wants you.
Just think it. That's such a good point. Let me ask you about the Craig Murray, former British ambassador to Uzbekistan, an associate of yours. He was quoted in the Daily Mail that he flew to Washington, D.C. for the emails. He claimed he had a clandestine handoff in a wooded area near American University with one of the email sources. And the leaker's motivation was, quote, disgust at the corruption of the Clinton Foundation and the tilting of the primary election playing field against Bernie Sanders. And he said the source had legal access to the information. The documents came from inside leaks, not from hacks.
Yeah, we don't comment on sourcing. Craig Murray is a former UK ambassador. He is a friend of mine. He is not authorized to speak on behalf of WikiLeaks.
Are you angry that he gave this interview?
I just don't want to go anywhere near that.
Okay, that's fine. But can I ask the question in a roundabout way without being annoying? I'm not trying to be annoying here. Is it much more likely that would have happened versus the Russians?
I don't want to be drawn on this.
Okay.
We have to protect our sources.
Understood.
So I can't be drawn on it.
Okay. When were you first alerted that someone had hacked these documents at Podesta?
That's an interesting question. Trying to cast my mind back. They took a while to prepare. So did the DNC leaks. So do other publications. It's quite a lot of work verifying them, formatting them, indexing them, understanding them. But for the same reason of making it hard for authorities to track when our sources have communicated with us, we don't like to mention precisely when we've obtained things.
Yeah, so there really is no evidence at all, and everyone's saying that the Russians has done this. Let me ask you whether, you know in the Manning case, was that a Russian attempt at undermining the Bush presidency with, you know, war logs giving liberals what they needed to erode in terms of the GOP and support and pave maybe the way for Barack Obama to win an election?
Well, we're such sticklers for this kind of thing. We've never said that Chelsea Manning is one of our sources. At trial, they have said that they are. But even if someone is arrested and convicted, and even if they were to plead guilty, we still don't say whether they're one of our sources or not, because someone in such a situation is under, you can argue, is under some kind of form of duress.
Let me ask you one last question for those, especially in the media, that will pick up.
There were no allegations at his trial that he was working for the Russians.
Let me ask you a question about your motivation, because in a private conversation we once had, without divulging the nature of that conversation, you said to me, I am a journalist. I get information that you think the public needs to know. You said to me you have no interest in information about private citizens, for example. And that you think what you have discovered exposes, I think if there were any good reporters in America, they would have taken the WikiLeaks information that I put up on a TV screen every night and I read on my radio program on 550 stations every day, and they would have taken the issue of how corrupt our media is, how corrupt the Clintons were, and they would have made this would have been a case bigger than Watergate. But for whatever reason, they've gone into this mode where they don't claim you're a journalist, that you're a traitor, and that divulging this information was only political. But I do believe if it was a Republican, they would have been singing your praises day and night. What do you want Americans to know about what your motives are?
Well, WikiLeaks has been going for 10 years. We specialize in obtaining information which has been suppressed from the public that is of political or historical importance, understanding it, analyzing it, publishing it, protecting our sources, encouraging interaction with the public. And that educates everyone, and they can decide how they want to live their lives accordingly. And we've won a lot of awards for that, a lot of journalism awards. I've won the equivalent of the Pulitzer Prize in my own country, Australia, the Walkley Award.
Sure.
Other journalists have won the top journalism prize in their country three times, in the case of Kristen Crapson. So we're pretty good at this. We have a perfect record.
No, I think you're pretty good.
We have a pretty big impact, as you will have seen.
I think you had a huge impact on this election, and it angers Democrats. Would you have published the same thing if it was about Donald Trump?
Absolutely. Yeah, no problem
so
saying that. And presume, you know, if Donald Trump makes a lot of enemies on the inside in his time in office, then he could well face the same thing in 4 years' time.
By the way, that is the best indication that this did not come from the Russians. I don't think you meant to say that. But listen, Julian, I do appreciate your time. I do think you had an impact. But I do think we got to see a glimpse of how corrupt the nature is. The institutions of American government and our political system are—it's actually frightening to me.
It is frightening. I think I love our publications. They're so rich, and you can get a very direct understanding of the power networks that exist in D.C. and with the media and so on. At the same time, yes, they're disturbing. But once you know what's going on, then you can do something about it.
And that was my argument about why I think America owes you a debt of gratitude for that and for the exposing that we have no cybersecurity. Julian, I've taken way too much of your time. Thank you so much for being with us. We really appreciate it. We hope you'll come on TV soon.
Thanks, Sean. Bye-bye. Take care.
800-941-SEAN, our toll-free telephone number.